All right. Hi, guys. So welcome to the first ever Summer Journalism Bootcamp at the FREEP. We're so excited to start. And our first session will be a speaker panel. So can all of our speakers introduce themselves?
I'm Samantha Gross. I'm a reporter at the Miami Herald, and I was an editor at the FREEP between the years 2016 to 2017.
I'm Sopan Deb. I'm a writer for the New York Times. I graduated BU in 2010, and I was a columnist. I was a sports columnist for one semester at the FREEP, and not a very good one.
And I'm Felicia Gans. I am covering education at the Boston Globe right now, and I graduated from BU in 2017. I was editor of the FREEP in 2015.
Yeah, so as for the moderators, I'm Angela Yang. I am the current editor-in-chief of the FREEP, and I'll be moderating alongside with Cami, so.
Hi, I'm Cami. I was multimedia editor last fall, and I currently intern at Business Insider.
So at any point throughout the session, you guys can submit answers or questions in the Q&A box, and then we'll have our speakers answer them. So yeah, first of all, to start off, can each of you tell me kind of how you discovered your interest in journalism and how you started pursuing that?
Who's going first? Does it matter?
You take the floor. Go for it.
You know, I went to BU to become a sports broadcaster. Initially, I thought that that's what I want to do with my life. I want to be like a play-by-play guy or whatever. And so I actually had kind of interest in journalism right from at the end of high school. And then when I got to college, you know, I did a lot of WTBU stuff. I was a sports director of the radio station. I wrote for the FREEP. I did like the Boston State House program and all that stuff. And over time, my interests kind of shifted from sports and I started doing other stuff. And then that's my first job out of college was at the Globe doing, working in this documentary unit they used to have. And that's kind of what set me on my path. But mostly I just wanted to tell stories, and journalism seemed like the best way to do that. And I'm not an academic person. I'm not good at math or science. So once you I don't enjoy like writing papers. So once you take all those things out, there's only like journalism left. So that's how I ended up doing this.
I knew that I wanted to pursue journalism in high school. I didn't really know what it was or what it meant. I just had, I love the cat appearance. I just knew that I kind of similar to Sopan, I liked writing stories and I liked telling people stories. I liked hearing from people. I felt like it kind of gave us access to a perspective in a world that we ourselves aren't experiencing. Everyone kind of has their own view on the world, but also their own experiences that are kind of shaping their view of the world. And it's impossible for you as a single person to ever have all perspectives. And so I always thought it was really cool to just hear where other people come from and what kind of experiences shape their own lives and what kind of passions are shaping their present lives. So that was kind of how I first got into it. I had a really, really cool high school journalism teacher. And I think that for a lot of people, whether they got into journalism in high school or college, having someone that kind of ignites that spark and gets you really excited, is really important. And someone who can kind of be a mentor and push you along the path. For me, it was a matter of somebody in high school that was interested in teaching us who we should aspire to be and who we should learn from. He was an English teacher too, so he had his moments of ranting about like Ralph Waldo Emerson and, you know, doing really, really absurd English teacher kind of things. But he also ignited a passion in the journalism side of it. Showed us the David Carr documentary. That was my first entry point to knowing who David Carr was before I even got to BU. He just did a lot of things that really made me aspire to become a working journalist. And then when I got to college, I took many of the similar paths that Sopan laid out too. I did the BU State House program. I joined the FREEP. And I met other people that you know, continue to inspire me and push me.
Yeah, like Felicia, I also had a really inspiring English teacher in high school who also ran our yearbook program. This is Frankie, by the way, she's my sidekick. but I, you know, really loved doing yearbook and the student newspaper in high school. And I was really bummed when I had to go to college. I was like, I don't know what I'm going to do. And that teacher was the one who told me, you know, there's a career, like you could do this. And so I kind of pursued that interest at BU. I did the free, you know, pretty much all 4 years in some capacity. I did the State House program. And I really loved, like Cami, I'm from Indiana. And when I got to Boston, I wanted to like get to know the city. And I think journalism provided me the opportunity to get outside of campus, report on things in the city, report on, you know, there was like major politics stories to be done. And I was always interested in politics. And yeah, I think like having those opportunities at the FREEP and beyond really kind of set me off on that path to, you know, I just love talking to people and getting outside of my comfort zone. And that's kind of what journalism is all about. So.
Thanks so much for sharing. The next question, I'll pass it to you. We'll start with you, Felicia. As a young reporter, what are some of the challenges you faced, and do you still encounter those challenges now in your career?
Yeah, I mean, it depends on the job you have and the kind of newsroom you're in. I think that there's the challenges you face in your own workplace and the challenges you're going to face being out in public, because obviously talking to the public and talking to sources is, I would say, the bigger and more important part of our job is being out in the community. As someone that didn't always and maybe still doesn't look my age, I think one of the biggest challenges I faced was just not being taken seriously. And I think I don't want to make it all about sexism. Part of it's being a woman, but part of it isn't. Part of it's just when people see someone that looks young, they kind of make a judgment call about how seriously they want to take them and how seriously they want to take their questions. It's something that I know Sam and I talk about a lot, and a lot of my other friends that graduated the same years as I did talk about, because it's a struggle, and it's really frustrating, and it really just comes down to continuing to stand your ground and prove yourself and not get pushed aside by it. It's not always easy to not let things bother you, but it's basically about just not letting things bother you and knowing that the questions you're asking make you good at your job. That if they're blowing you off or seem pissed off by your question, it's probably because you asked a good question, probably not because you're a bad journalist, and just kind of continuing to push forward. And then the challenges you face in your own newsroom for me, I've always been in every job I've been on mostly the digital side of things. I'm a digital producer and a reporter. And so a lot of my work has to do with audience engagement and social media, and making sure that stories get in front of the right audiences and that the people that are interested in them are actually being able to view and read those stories and also engage with us as reporters. And that's not always innately what print reporters were taught in journalism school. And so a lot of the push and pull ends up being working with colleagues that just simply went to journalism school in a different decade. It's not that they are any worse at their jobs. In fact, they are much, much better than me in many ways. There's so much that I continue to learn from those reporters, but we think about things in different ways often. We approach stories in different ways. So that's a lot of the push and pull, that it's not a globe specific thing. It happens in every single newsroom. It's that people come at stories from different angles and think about them in different ways and write headlines for different types of audiences and finding ways to merge all of our skills and ultimately create a story that works for both scenarios is probably the biggest challenge, but exciting challenge.
Sorry, I'm here. I think I'm glad you asked the two journals who actually are young on this call should go first in answering that question. As a formerly young person, I actually think that the biggest challenge that young journalists face when they, you know, in their 20s is twofold. One is getting hired, because so much of this industry is based on who you know and being at the right place at the right time. And secondly, just being able to pay rent, because in a lot of these places, you know, if you want to start as a local TV reporter, you know, you have to start at a small market, you're getting paid $20,000 a year. My first job at the Globe coming out of college, I got paid $20,000, and that's to live in Boston. I mean, it takes a long, I mean, it's just hard to even just survive on the kind of money that young journalists get paid. You know, my second job was as an assistant producer at NBC for a show called Rock Center with Brian Williams. And my pay was, with overtime, $45,000 a year. And for those of you who've not lived in New York City, that's not an easy, you can't make a living like that. I mean, you don't have any money. You can't even pay rent with that. So I actually think that, I mean, just the pay and getting hired, especially with today, with the pandemic and all that going on, I think it's really difficult for young journalists to break into the industry and survive in the industry. And there's not incentive for them to stay long-term because, you know, there's more money in to do with these same skills to do other things.
Yeah. I mean, that's very real. What Sopan said, my first job out of college, I was temporary. So I didn't have very high pay and I didn't have any benefits. And so I had to do some other side things, but ultimately, I think like the biggest challenge is kind of echoes to what Felicia said about being taken seriously and having the confidence to stand up for yourself and to ask the questions that you need to ask. But I think, at least in my experience, with time, it's gotten so much easier because the more experience that you have and the more times that you've had to deal with asking hard questions, the more confident you feel in yourself that your questions are valid, that you're a good reporter, you're doing your best. So I think that like a lot of my challenges have gotten better with time, but they still definitely exist. And like Felicia, I'm only a couple years out of school and I look pretty young, and sometimes that could definitely be a roadblock. But I think my biggest challenge has been, getting enough self-confidence to not let that inhibit my work. And it's gotten better, but it's definitely still,
If I can piggyback off that, imposter syndrome is obviously a real thing, especially for younger reporters. You know, when I got hired at the Times, I think I was 29. And, 10, 20 years ago, it was unheard of for the Times to hire reporters, in their 20s that had never written for a newspaper before. So imposter syndrome is real, but what I will say, the way I've been able to grapple with it at the Times or any other job I've had is, once you're hired for a job, you're in the door. Whether you think you can do the job or not, an entity has decided that you are worthy of that job. And whether you believe it or not, you still have to do the job because your paycheck is dependent on you doing the job, whether you believe you can do it or not. So you have two choices there: either do the job because that's what you're hired to do, or don't do it because you feel you can't. But if you don't do it, you will lose that job, whether you feel you can do it or not. So all you can control is your own actions and how you react to it. So one way or another, whether you believe you deserve a particular job or not, someone else has decided that for you. So anyway, that's how I've dealt with imposter syndrome.
Yeah, and I know that all three of you guys were involved in college journalism, and a lot of our attendees here are either in college or going into college. So could you kind of describe how involved were you in extracurriculars and how much of your young journalism experience came from organizations on campus, for example, as compared to journalism classes themselves?
Go ahead. So I was a comm ambassador in college, so I gave tours of comm once a week, and I, kind of served in this position. And one thing I told my groups every single time, so I often had a lot of journalism students, was that like the comm classes are great, meeting professors who are going to help you is awesome. But the best place to learn how to do journalism is to do journalism, whether it's at the Freep, like the path I chose, or, the radio station, or, the many magazines on campus. But learning by doing, I think, is so invaluable. I was super involved at the Freep. I did like every job at the Freep. I was a writer, I did multimedia, I did video stuff. I was the design, layout editor. And having your hands in every part of the paper, I think gave me such a good understanding, not only of, how to do journalism, how to work in a newsroom and like be collaborative, but also to build connections with other people on staff who became lifelong friends, but also, you know, connections for your career. Learning how to write a story, you know, your first semester of your freshman year is so invaluable. You don't get to take those classes at BU until a little bit later on. So I don't know. I think that doing extracurriculars and really learning by doing is the best thing. And I don't think it has to be one particular extracurricular. The FREEP was amazing in my experience. But yeah, it's, I think that you can get so much more from doing, you know, creating real work than sitting in a classroom personally.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I mean, that's, I lived at the FREEP. Sam and I mostly lived at the FREEP over the same years. Sam and I actually, there was like a 3-day period of time when neither Sam nor I actually went anywhere but reporting on a court trial and the FREEP, and we wore the same outfit over those 3 days, and people kept seeing us and realizing we had never gone home to actually change our clothes. It was kind of gross, but it kind of prepared us for the pandemic, if we're being real. But no, I mean, I agree. It doesn't have to be the FREEP. It can be any extracurricular that, first of all, your medium might not be print journalism, so the FREEP might not be relevant to you. So whatever medium fits for you. But being in a newsroom or a news setting, whatever you plan to pursue as much as possible is the best thing you can do while you're in college. Like Sam, I did a lot of different positions at the FREEP. I did city news associate. I was business editor at one point, and then I became managing editor and editor in chief. And so I spent a lot of hours at the FREEP, and every semester I was there, I was learning something new. I think that there's this perception, and I try to remind myself of this even now in a professional newsroom, there's this perception that the people that have risen to these editorial positions, these high editor positions, they know all, they're done learning, they're just there to teach. And especially when you're in college, that cannot be further from the truth. I mean, the semester that I was editor in chief, and Sam was one of my right hand men that semester, like we dealt with David Carr passing away. We dealt with the Sarnaev trial. We dealt with really, really serious and also deeply personal and sad things for our own staff, and figuring out how to learn as journalists and also be there for emotional support for each other is really important. And that is something that you continue to do as a journalist in a professional newsroom. I mean, any of the Boston Marathon coverage, even this past Friday when there was new news on the Sarnaev trial, that's deeply personal. And it really hurts for a lot of people that were here living in the city, especially people that might have been running the marathon that day. So figuring out how to be kind of a member of your community and a journalist at the same time is something that you continue to learn over the course of your career. But it was the first place that I didn't learn that in high school journalism. You just don't get that kind of experience. So giving yourself the chance to do that is something you don't get from classes. When you're in a classroom, it's just a different, I loved my professors. It wouldn't have been the same if I wasn't taking journalism classes, but I didn't get that from journalism classes.
You know, we like to think that the world is a meritocracy, and that, you know, it's like the movies where if you work hard enough and you get pulled up by your bootstraps and you're going to rise in whatever you want to do. Journalism is not really like that. It can be for some people, but it's not for a lot of people. And this is, as I said before, you know, what's really, if you want to survive and you want to, you know, thrive in as a journalist, you have to really know a lot of people. And that's where, you know, doing internships and you know, doing the free, doing all that stuff is really very essential, you know, because you want to, you know, especially when it comes to internships and stuff, you want advocates for yours. So when you graduate college, you have people to, you know, call upon and be like, hey, you know, hey, Bob at the Times, we met at the, you know, when I did the fellowship in college, you know, is the Times hiring anybody? Because you can have the most amazing bylines, you can have the most amazing resume or whatever coming out of school, but if you don't know the right people, you know, it's going to be really harder. It's going to be much harder for you to get hired. So, I mean, so now with all that being said, I also think it's important for you to do stuff on campus that has nothing to do with your resume. And that was a big regret of mine from college, is that almost everything I did, I worked myself to the bone doing stuff, you know, journalism stuff, doing internships and this and that. And it was always about the resume. And I actually think college is also about social development as much as it is about your professional development and academic development. And so you should do some stuff that has absolutely nothing to do with work or academics. Like go, you know, if you're into comedy, go join an improv group. If you like music, a cappella group, whatever, go do something that can help you take your mind off stuff that, you know, go do something that you don't have to like put pressure on yourself to do. Because when I graduated college, and this was now 10 years ago, I was pretty burned out because I was just spent so much of my time in college polishing my journalism career. And I, you know, so I was already entering the workforce, you know, feeling like I was the age I am now. So I think it's also, you know, you should find some stuff that has nothing to do with, you know, the industry.
I agree with that so much. I distinctly remember sitting at my comm graduation, the sectional one, and I honestly forget who our speaker was, but I remember that the main premise of her speech, Sam heard me complain about this for like 2 years afterwards, the main premise of her speech was never say no to anything. Go out in the world and open your wings and say yes to everything. And I remember sitting there the entire time thinking, I just spent 4 years saying yes to everything. I'm done with that. I'm burnt out. I don't want to say yes to everything. And then sure enough, I jumped into doing overnights for a year and a half. And so I did say yes to everything. But all that being said, it's true that like you need something that's going to distract you and that's going to, it, like Sopan said, it won't feel forced to do. Something that you enjoy doing. And for me, like I joined BU Hillel. I honestly don't talk about a lot of my non-journalism stuff in college because it does feel like it's just kind of this separate part of my life, but I was really involved in Hillel. And that was kind of my getaway place where it wasn't for my resume. It was just kind of this place that other than the Freep, it was the one place on campus that really felt like home for me. And it's still something, I'm on the alumni council now, like it's something that I've continued to keep in my life. And so that's important in college and also out of college, is finding things that are not for your resume, that are not for career development, they're not for networking, it's literally just for you and it makes you happy. Because there's a lot of journalism that to get into the field and to crack into it, you are going to have to say yes to a lot of things that are not the greatest situations, whether it's bad hours or bad pay or both. There's a lot of things you're going to kind of have to open up to, especially in your 20s. So having those things that are separate that make you happy are really important.
Yeah, I think with student journalists, especially, like a lot of the time, our life begins to revolve around journalism. And so burnout is really prevalent. We do have a few questions in our Q&A box. The first one is from Isabella. It says, do you think it is difficult for non-journalism majors to break into the industry and make it?
No, not at all. In fact, if I could do it over, now, I wouldn't have gotten a journalism degree. I mean, Brian Williams, who is an MSNBC anchor, doesn't even have a college degree. I think he dropped out of multiple colleges. You don't even need a degree. I'm not saying everybody should go drop out, but this is not an academic field. It's an experience-based field. I have people that I work with that, you know, a lot of people I work with don't have journalism degrees. The answer is no. I'll just leave it at that.
I'll say the most interesting people that I work with in my newsroom were not journalism majors. They majored in, you know, really cool things like, you know, Greek literature or anthropology or, you know, these things that they're really deeply interested in. And I think that makes them not only more interesting people, but I think it brings like another level to their writing. I don't know how to explain it, but when you don't spend 4 years of college thinking about journalism, I think those people are special. And I don't think you need a journalism degree to do journalism. Like Sopan said, this is not an academic field. This is an experience-based field. And if you love to write and you love to talk to people and you make the connections you need to get your foot in the door to write for someone, I think, you know, anyone could be a good journalist. You don't need a journalism degree.
Yeah, one of, actually our very last editors-in-chief was an economics major, and I think she brought really insightful ideas to her editorial meetings. She was always, just like, she did bring this level of thought and insight that I feel like journalism majors solely may not actually think of. We have a question from Juhi. what was the process of landing these jobs / internships during and after college? And do you have any tips for networking or building a portfolio?
So I can start. Part of it was things that I did in college and figuring out while you're doing those things, whether you could envision yourself working in those newsrooms. So I did that. I did the Globe co-op when I was a junior in college. And I knew right when I did the co-op that the Globe would be kind of my dream job. I didn't really think that it was, I mean, the Globe was in a hiring freeze when I was doing a co-op, so it really didn't seem like any kind of possibility that I could be there. But I kind of always kept it in the back of my mind that I wanted to do everything a student could possibly do at in that newsroom to set myself up to possibly be there. And then I also did the BU State House program my senior year for the Lowell Sun, and that was another newsroom where I could see myself there, and I was enjoying the reporting I was doing. I was based in Boston, and so I wasn't in the newsroom so much, but the Lowell Sun has over time become a lot of Freep alums go there, and so I happen to know of a lot of people. One of the reporters there happened to be one of my first editor-in-chiefs when I was a freshman at the Freep, so it was easy to kind of envision myself there. So as far as the transition, I mean, it's just about being open with those editors. There's nothing wrong with telling an editor what your intentions are, saying that you're interested in working there one day, or saying that you're going to be reminding them when you're going to graduate, reminding them when you're going to be looking for a job, you know, doing it in a way that's, you know, it's not an everyday conversation. A lot of it is speaking through your work and showing them what a good worker you are and how much you can learn and how much you can be an asset to the newsroom. That's important too. But making your intentions known is important. I mean, there's so many times when editors are short-staffed the same way that reporters often feel like they could use extra hands. Editors feel that way too. And if you don't remind them of what your intentions are and when you're going to be available to possibly be full-time, it won't necessarily be on their minds. So don't be shy about voicing what you want.
I ended up in my job due to some creative maneuvering, which I can share. But I did an internship at the Miami Herald after my junior year, and I loved the Herald. I loved working in Miami. I loved working in Florida. Like I mentioned earlier on this panel, I'm really interested in politics, and Florida is like the place, in my opinion, to cover politics. And I kept in touch with people from the internship. I even went to Miami to visit. I like loved my friends that I made there. And one of the reporters in our State House Bureau in Tallahassee was leaving for a one-year fellowship at Harvard, the Nieman Fellowship. And so I reached out and I was like, do you guys need help there? Because she's going to be gone. And they said, you know, we didn't really think about filling that job. And, you know, I had some interviews with some editors there, and I ended up taking a temporary 9-month contract to help out in the Tallahassee Bureau and cover the legislative session, the 2018 midterm, a hurricane. You know, it was a busy year, and that was a really good time for me to show my chops, and I eventually got hired at the end of that. So I would recommend, you know, thinking of, like, if you do an internship and you really want to work there, like, think about ways that you can get in the door. And yeah, I think, you know, with some creative maneuvering and pitching some good ideas, that could definitely can make it happen.
I think that to answer the other part of the question, which is, you know, what's a good way to network? There are a whole bunch of journalism groups around the country, like NAHJ, which is National Association of Hispanic Journalists, SAJA, South Asian Journalism Association, NABJ, which is like the biggest one, National Association of Black Journalists, ONA, Online News Association. Join those groups, because those are great ways to meet people. A lot of them have yearly conventions, and at the conventions they'll have job fairs for you to meet recruiters and you know, meet kind of the higher ups at all the news organizations. I think there's one for there's one for LGBTQ journalists, and you don't have to be those particular demographic groups to be part of those groups. There are plenty of, you know, white people in NABJ, for example. But I would really recommend joining those groups if you're interested. And then, you know, also don't be afraid to cold email people. Now, I get a decent amount of cold emails from college students being like, hey, can we chat? And And I try to answer as many of those as I can. A lot of people won't answer you, but you know, fortune favors the bold, as they say. One thing I would say, my biggest tip on networking is don't just have one conversation, you know, check back in, you know, keep in touch with people that go out of their way to talk to you, because you don't want to make the other people feel like you're only reaching out when you need something, because those aren't the people, then that person's not going to be a true advocate for you. But build a real relationship with the people you network with, and you actually build true advocacy for yourself.
So kind of moving backwards from all of that, how did you guys land your first internship ever?
Oh, I remember mine. Mine was, I did overnights at WFAN, which is a sports radio station in New York. And and this was at a time when it was normal for interns to not be paid. So I would commute in 2 or 3 hours from New Jersey to work overnight in New York. And then I think my shift was like midnight to 6 a.m. I remember, and it really simply, what I did was, what you do is, I don't know if it's still the case, but I would just Google places I wanted to intern, and I would look on their like sites and see what the intern program was. And then I'd either call or I'd email and just kind of get in touch with the people until I got a hold of somebody. Like, I wouldn't let the site have some generic like apply here to be an intern. Like, I would get in touch with somebody. And so applied, I interviewed, and you know, wore a suit, you know, and that internship was 3 months unpaid, fetching coffee. So that was my first experience, my first line on my resume.
My first internship was also unpaid, which I hate unpaid internships. Let me just say that. I did two of them, and there's obviously a privilege that comes with being able to do them. The reason I did my first internship unpaid was because it was the summer in between my freshman and sophomore year. I knew that the only way I could do an unpaid internship was if I was back at home with my parents. I wasn't going to be able to go off somewhere and do an unpaid internship. I'm from South Jersey, and so my circle was fairly small as to the organizations that I could intern for. I also didn't have my own car, still don't have my own car because I've always lived in a city. And so I had a very small group that were within like a 5 to 10 mile radius of my parents' home. One was called South Jersey Magazine. And like Sopan said, I literally reached out to them. They didn't have a fill in the blank for, you know, a please apply here on their website. I reached out to an editor and I was like, do you need an intern this summer? And I got hired for like 10 hours a week unpaid. I really wanted more. I was actually fairly bored that summer. And looking back, I wish I had done some freelance. I wish I had tried to do something else with my summer, because I truthfully wasn't doing a ton that summer. But yeah, it was pretty similar. I was doing a lot of remedial administrative tasks. I remember putting together like the best schools in New Jersey list, and it was literally just a matter of like fact checking the school districts to make sure it was the right name and the right capitalization. It was frustrating. I mean, the first internships you're going to get, especially if you're straight out of your freshman year of college, are often going to be internships like that where they often look at you as someone that just finished your freshman year, and you might look at yourself correctly as someone who just did a full year of college journalism, and you feel like I could be doing so much more right now than fact-checking names of school districts. But especially in those early years, the connections are important, and you know, you need to kind of find, with internships, you need to find the middle ground between, you don't want to be bored, you don't want to feel like you're being abused, especially if you're unpaid. You don't want to feel like you're not learning anything from it or that you're not growing. But especially in your early years, you also want to find a way to make those connections and not come across as arrogant, not come across as walking in the door and saying, I deserve X, Y, and Z. So you just kind of find the middle ground. And if you're ever in an internship where you do feel bored, especially if bored means that you have a lot of extra time, not just that you're bored with the task, but that you actually are finishing the task and then have nothing to do, don't be shy about telling your editor that or whoever your boss is and saying, is there something else I can help with? Because if the issue is that you have more hours in the day than they're filling up, they'd be happy to have extra help. So always make that known to them.
Yeah, similar to Sophia and Felicia, my first internship was also unpaid. like Cami, I'm from Indiana. And so the options were few, but I ended up getting an internship at a magazine that no longer exists, that was part of the Chicago Sun-Times network. It's called Splash Magazine. And I did a lot of like interviewing brides, like about their weddings in Chicago and stuff like that. And I took the train from Indiana to Chicago every day. Did a lot of fetching sushi and fancy lunches for the people who worked there. But I also got to pitch some of my own stories, and I got to interview like my first celebrity. I got to cover Lollapalooza in Chicago. And so, you know, kind of getting over a fear of like interviewing people who are kind of outside your comfort zone. Like, it was super fun summer. But, you know, I had the privilege to do an unpaid internship, and, you know, I value that. And that definitely helped, you know, using the Chicago Sun-Times name, even though I wasn't at the paper, helped kind of, you know, lead from one thing to the next. So I think my advice on, you know, first internships is that there's no publication too small. Like, one thing always leads to another, and it's just, you know, it's good experience if you can get it.
So that leads into our next question. How have each of you adjusted to the way you conduct your journalistic work in the last few months with the pandemic going on?
It's been hard. I cover politics, and so there's a lot of really competitive races statewide in Florida, in addition to the presidential election, obviously. And campaigns have gone digital. And so I've definitely sharpened my Zoom skills, and I think it takes a lot of work to kind of reach out to people and set up calls and really be active when you can't be physically in their face, you know, asking questions. And also, you know, when there are events in person, my paper has done a really good job of making sure that we're protected and wearing full PPE as much as we can, to cover events. But it's definitely been an interesting couple months to shift to this digital, focus, but I think I've been able to squeeze in even more interviews, and I've actually been really productive, you know, being able to schedule things digitally. It's been interesting. I don't know about you guys.
Well, I write about the NBA, so the last couple of months have been very different for me. But, you know, I mostly work from home, or I'm traveling anyway, because that's the function of my job. Yeah, it was strange. Like, you know, you don't know, it was kind of difficult to find things to write about, because there's the main segment of my job was not in existence. So, it's been strange. So, hopefully, you know, now basketball's back up, so it's a little bit more regular now, but you know, I don't know what the long-term, you know, what this looks like, but I love working from home. For me personally, like it's the best part about this whole thing. I really enjoy just rolling out of bed and it being my office. So that part's been great.
Yeah, remote working definitely has its perks. A lot of my job is on the audience engagement side. And so a lot of it, even when we were in the office, I mostly worked in the office. I didn't do a ton of going out. So in a sense, some of my job hasn't changed. From an actual reporting standpoint, though, when I started the pandemic, I was on the cannabis beat. And the week that everything shut down was actually the week of the first Boston pot shop opening. And we always on that beat now talk about that week. I mean, everyone kind of has their story about that week in March. But for us, it's like the weirdest thing, because on Monday, March 9th of that week, we were all crushed into this teeny tiny room doing a press avail. You know, it was like a joke, which it's awful to even say that, but it's like, you know, we're all standing really close and we're just like, haha, coronavirus, maybe we shouldn't be doing this. And within 2 days, I was like cringing. I mean, I was counting my 14 days because I was like, I cannot believe I did that on Monday. Why? I wasn't even wearing a mask. I was like hugging people that I hadn't seen in a while. Just no worries at all. And within days, it completely changed. I mean, the first Boston pot shop was other than the fact that it was the first in Boston, which was important, it was also the first Black-owned pot shop in Boston, in Massachusetts. And so it was a really big victory for this industry that fights so hard to help people who were disproportionately hurt by the war on drugs. And then suddenly the store, after being open for 2 weeks, was being told they had to shut down, along with thousands of other businesses. It wasn't them alone. But it was just, it was the opposite of what anyone in the cannabis industry had ever wanted to see, of course. So a lot of our reporting really shifted to figuring out how to cover businesses on the ground without being able to be there on the ground. Before, when we were covering pot shop openings, we could just go and stand outside the pot shops. We could talk to the owners. We could stand in line. We could talk to customers. All of a sudden, the story was that none of those things were there. The story was that customers weren't, any customer that hadn't become a medical marijuana patient couldn't get their products. And any business owner that suddenly opened and had to close within 2 weeks, they couldn't get any federal funds because marijuana is federally illegal. I mean, there were a lot of issues that were coming into play that we had to kind of figure out how to cover from our living rooms. So for me, it was a little bit less about changing my routine and more just changing how we could actually report this story. And it was difficult, but we figured it out. We were all in the same boat. So we just kind of figured it out as we went.
Yeah, and so all of you guys have your individual beats. Like Felicia, you did cannabis and now you do education. And then Sopan does basketball, Sam does politics. So one of the questions in our Q&A box has to do with writing about topics that you're not necessarily interested in. So before you developed those beats, did you ever have to cover things that you didn't know a lot about and didn't even necessarily have an interest in? And how did you deal with that?
Yeah, I've covered several beats. I covered the 2016 campaign. I did culture before, and I still write about culture now. I've done, some wildlife coverage and I've done breaking news like hurricanes and I think I covered the Boston Marathon bombing and all that stuff. I think that a good journalist should be able to cover anything. And obviously, if you speak a bunch of different languages and whatever, there are things that'll make that easier for you. But the muscles are the same, right? You're doing the same thing, no matter the topic. So yeah, I mean, look, if the Times came to me and offered me a job covering, I don't know, like Renaissance art, would I feel comfortable taking that job? No, I'm not an art history person, but like I'd figure it out. Some jobs require like an institutional knowledge of stuff, some beats rather. But even then, I think you can figure it out by talking to the right people, cultivating the right sources that can kind of teach you and stuff. So journalism is a very, I think, nebulous thing in that you should be able to, you have the skills to write about whatever you want, provided you're willing to do the right research and take the proper nuance into things.
Yeah, I will say, like, in terms of cultivating an interest in a beat that you might be assigned to that you're not, naturally interested in, I think that with journalism, like, the reason that we do it is because we want to tell stories, right? We want to talk to people, we want to tell stories of people whose stories might, be underrepresented. For instance, this past legislative session in Florida, I was assigned to cover health policy, which is very complex, and learning about how, each state's health system works in tandem with the federal, health system, Medicaid, Medicare. It's hard, but I don't know. I think once I found like people to tell those stories through, the job got so much easier because in any beat, if you're finding the people to interview and to kind of elevate their voices, I don't think any beat is uninteresting, right? Because everyone has kind of an interesting story to tell. Health insurance might be boring on its face, but when you're talking to a mom who has a child with diabetes that can't afford insulin because there's no cap on insulin prices, and a lot of insurance companies won't cover it, those are the stories that are interesting. And so I think that, I've definitely been assigned to beats. Like when I got assigned health policy, I was like, oh my God, I don't know what I'm going to do. But finding the people, finding the sources to tell those stories through, I think that's, the best way to approach it. And that's kind of the core of journalism is, finding the people, not just the ideas.
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, I'd be lying if I didn't say that when they said, hey, we're going to take you off of pot and put you on education, that didn't sound like a less interesting beat compared to covering pot. I think we all have beats. I also don't have children myself. And so education isn't something that prior to being an education reporter, I paid a lot of attention to. I paid attention to when our schools were closing statewide, but it doesn't affect my day-to-day lives. It wasn't until I started talking, like Sam said, to the people. When you start talking to teachers and parents, you start to really hear what they're passionate about, what they're concerned about. I personally just find it really hard to talk to someone who's really passionate about something and then not be interested in what they're saying. I mean, when you talk to someone who, whether that passion comes through as excitement and happiness or whether they're really frustrated and sad and angry about something, it's just really hard to listen to their story and then remain apathetic about it. So even yesterday, I was talking on the phone with a kindergarten teacher about her school district announcing they were going to go remote only. And she was saying, you know, I didn't want to be remote. I really did want to be in school. But I'm a kindergarten teacher, and they were telling me that I couldn't touch any of the kids. Well, what do I do when the five-year-olds have their shoelaces untied? I just stare at them, and I tell them, learn how to tie your own shoes. Or like when they sneeze and they have snot running down their face and they're 5 years old and they need someone to wipe their nose because they're 5 years old. I'm supposed to stand there and just throw a tissue at them and be like, learn it yourself. And so hearing those stories, I mean, I got off the phone and I was right away telling my fiance about it because it's things that I wasn't thinking about until I got on the phone with this woman and heard what was on her mind and heard the things that she's passionate about. So like Sam said, I don't know that any beat is really uninteresting once you dig into it.
So in recent weeks, we've seen a lot of various attacks on journalists, especially amid the protests. And so how do each of you respond to criticism, whether that's on the journalism industry as a whole or just your personal work?
I want to throw in one thing and just say that criticism and attacks on the First Amendment are two totally different things. So I'll say that from the start, the protests and the attacks on journalists and arrests of journalists anger me in a way that getting critiques to my inbox from readers don't. Because someone critiquing my work is also their First Amendment right, and I'm always interested in hearing people's critiques. Someone trying to take away my ability to report a story angers me in a totally different way.
How do I handle criticism? Not well. No. I think that I try not to engage with it that much, although it's really hard not to because, you know, there's no barrier to entry on like Twitter, right? Because you just type in something and you hit tweet. But truthfully, you know, especially when I covered the Trump campaign, you know, I was on the receiving end of a Trump tweets, plural, you know. I also was arrested covering the Trump campaign, as some of you might know. And I was, you know, charged with a felony for covering a protest. So to Felicia's point, absolutely, there's a difference between criticism and you know, the institution of the state trying to keep you from doing your job. But I think you're in control of one thing, which is how you react to things. And at the end of the day, for me personally, how I think about it is I'm trying to make two people happy with my journalism, myself and my editor. And I'm trying to be, you know, faithful to the subject, you know, whatever. But at the end of the day, you're not going to make everybody happy, you know, especially today. I think people have this, this hope or this assumption that journalists are supposed to be cheerleaders for them and activists and you know, and that's just not a realistic, it's not our job to advance a particular cause. And that doesn't mean that by chance we don't do that occasionally, because there are certain things that I don't think are up for, like, that are causes, you know, like racism and whatever. But all that is to say is I try to drown out the criticism because at the end of the day, like, not everyone's going to be happy with what you're doing. Now, if it's something if I feel like I'm getting like bad faith stuff thrown my way, I'll respond. And then I'll like age 5 years in the course of an hour. and then, you know, I'll feel bad about engaging. Don't get into Twitter feuds, because no one ever wins a Twitter feud. Like, no one ever engaging critics on Twitter is generally a dead end. No one's minds are going to be changed. But no one ever wins that stuff. So don't try to rise above the fray. As someone who has failed often at doing that.
I don't know if I have much more to add. I think Sopan said it really well, is that, like, you know, with when it comes to criticism and when it comes to attacks on the press, which, as Felicia rightfully noted, are very different. Like the only people that you are trying to please in those situations are yourself and staying true to your work and your editor. And, you know, I've been covering a lot of the Black Lives Matter protests in Miami, where the press is not very well received among some communities. And a lot of times it just, you know, there's hundreds and hundreds of people there and you've got to just kind of pick your battles and move to the next group of people and try to see if, you know, folks want to talk. And I don't know, I think that there's a certain amount of respect between the community and a journalist where, you know, in sensitive situations, sometimes you have to kind of recognize that, you know, you are the outsider in a certain situation. And, you know, I think that takes a little, you know, respect and maturity to kind of realize that, you know, it's time to move on, especially when you're with a photographer and things can get kind of sensitive about people, you know, having their photos taken. You know, in certain situations, you have to recognize that you don't want to put anyone in danger. You're just trying to do your job and tell your story. And you can accomplish that job sometimes by just moving on and, you know, kind of moving to the next thing. So as long as you're doing your job and, yeah, like Sopan said, you know, if you're proud of the story at the end of the day, then that's all you can do.
So what are some of the skill sets that you guys are most proud of developing or have helped you most in your career? And are there any skills that you guys feel would have benefited you and wish you'd learned them earlier?
Oh, that's a good question. You guys can take that one first if you want.
I will say, I wish that I took more computer science classes in college. Because I've learned, especially with COVID and the way that we are reporting on COVID in Florida, having data skills is really helpful, and being able to, you know, being able to run code through large swaths of numbers to make kind of sense of that. I wish I had those skills, and we have reporters in our newsroom who are great at that. but that is one skill I wish I had. And one skill that has helped me, I took a lot of Spanish classes in college, and my Spanish has gotten a lot better living in Miami, and I value that skill and being able to communicate with my community here, which is largely Spanish speaking. And, you know, especially I cover politics and, you know, the Latino vote is so crucial in Florida, which is a very purple state. I don't know. I think it's helped me a lot in my reporting, but I wish I had computer science skills.
I would say similar. And for me, not taking Spanish is a regret of mine. And it goes way back. I mean, I think I chose a language in like eighth grade. And I chose French and I stuck with French. And by the time I got to college, my choice was to start over or to keep taking French. And I just kept taking French. And it has never helped me in journalism. Because in most cases, you're not going, unless you, there are specific pockets of the country, but in most cases, you're not going to find a lot of communities in the US that only speak French. And that's much more common of Spanish. And I run into a lot of cases where even if I wasn't fluent in it in a way that I'd feel confident translating myself and reporting and quoting, I would like to at least have a conversational level. I find a lot of times especially when I was covering crime in my early days at Globe, when I was going into communities and I couldn't even communicate with people there. And especially when you're covering something that's tragic, that's really sensitive, it's really hard to not be able to even say, I'm sorry for your loss in another language, in the language that they speak. So that's definitely a regret of mine. And it's not to say that I can't learn it myself, but it obviously is one of those things that is much easier to learn when you're in a class atmosphere. When you have a professor who's a fluent speaker themselves and you're able to ask them questions. So if you're still in a place in high school or college where you can make Spanish your language that you take, I would strongly recommend that. computer science is helpful, but computer science I've found I've been able to teach myself more of on my own. That's a little bit easier to just kind of pick up in your free time. Learning a language is just very, very difficult to do by yourself.
Yeah, learning a language is a good one. I mean, beyond that, I don't really have much that I wish I knew. And not because I knew everything, but more because I learned as I went. And that's one of the big benefits of doing this job and being in this field, is that you learn about a lot of new stuff as you go. I mean, you know, when I covered the campaign, you know, I learned a whole bunch of shit about campaign finance that I never would have otherwise known. And so I think you get into, you know, one of the things about being a journalist is that you also get an education. That's one of the benefits. So there isn't much that I felt like I wished I knew beforehand, because I just kind of did it as I went along.
So this will probably be our last question that we have time for. And I think it's pretty interesting. How do you kind of convince or just like coax someone into talking to you if they're reluctant to do so for whatever reason? And what are just some like skills that you find are helpful when interviewing someone?
That's a great question. And everybody has different approaches, I think. I think journalists sometimes they forget that there's a human on the other end of who they're talking to. So because a journalist will sometimes be focused on their deadline, they just need to get a quote, they just need to, you know, and there's a human on the other end. So if you treat the person as a human, and how you would any other human, with kindness and empathy and you know, they're going to be more likely to talk to you. And you also have to be okay and let that person know that it's okay if they don't. Sometimes journalists have this, you know, belief that they're obligated for people to talk to them. And that is certainly the case for like public officials and people in power. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about, like, let's say someone has a sexual misconduct story, you know, at a corporation or something. In those kind of situations, I think it's really important to listen and be empathetic. And then in terms of interviewing people, something that you have to listen. Listening is, I think, the most important thing about doing interviews, because inevitably the best answers are going to come in the follow-ups that you ask. And you saw that this weekend, Jonathan Swan of Axios, he did a pretty good interview with Donald Trump. And granted, Donald Trump has not done many non-friendly interviews in the last 2 years or so, so it was less notable than I think people were making it out to be. But Jonathan just kept asking follow-up after follow-up after follow-up after follow-up. And that was a result of him listening and being prepared with facts. So anyway, those are kind of my thoughts on interviewing and empathy. And I mean, you should be empathetic as a human anyway, but you know, but especially so when you're doing interviews.
Yeah, I think, you know, I agree that every situation is also very different. You have to kind of treat it in different ways. Obviously, a public official or someone who's elected, you can be a little bit tenacious. I mean, they should be able to answer to questions, especially if it's something, you know, regarding misconduct. But with normal people, it takes a level of care. And I cover the prison system here in Florida as well. I cover a couple state agencies. And I talk to a lot of inmate families who are super, you know, when they talk to the press, they see repercussions to their family member in prison. It's how our prison system is. It's not right, but it happens. And so a lot of times it takes conversations with my editors. Can we talk off the record? Can we have a background conversation first before maybe you're comfortable going on the record? And it might take a couple interviews to kind of get to a place where you feel like you have a mutual understanding of how an interview will go. And that goes for, you know, victims of other sorts of crimes that I've interviewed or anything like that. But sometimes it just takes some time, and sometimes you're not going to get a quote in the first interview, and you have to really be patient and listen and make eye contact and really show that you're a human without putting yourself in the conversation. But yeah, I mean, sometimes it takes an off the record conversation or guaranteed anonymity, and that's a conversation you have to have with your editors. But I think, you know, time, patience, giving somebody the space that they need and the comfort level that they need in a certain interview is key. And that's what's helped me you know, talk to some people in some pretty sensitive situations.
Yeah, I agree with all that's been said. I think the key thing is that our jobs isn't to coax people, not to break apart the premise of the question, but, you know, when we're talking to the average person, and again, elected officials, appointed officials are completely different. And also institutions are different. I mean, I don't go easy now on schools. That I called a school yesterday and I said, you know, who handles your press? And she goes, no one. And then she didn't want to talk to me either. I mean, an institution needs to have someone who's confident speaking for that institution. So in those cases, it's fine for you to, I wouldn't even say coax, but insist that somebody speak to you. But when you're talking to the average person, when you're doing a sensitive story, it's less about coaxing and more about informing them of what you're doing. I find that a lot of people, you know, like Sam said, people don't speak to reporters for a lot of reasons, but some of it is because they're worried about the repercussions. They're worried about what it'll do to themselves, whether it's their jobs or their families. Just they don't want it to hurt their lives. In listening to, I mean, Sopan said this, but listening to what their concerns are is really important. I think a lot of people go into this coaxing with a source thinking that they understand, you know, maybe the source just hates journalists and they just kind of go in with this, I'm telling your story. And, you know, they kind of go off their boilerplate answers. And you need to listen to what a source is actually concerned about. Because if they're concerned, you know, if they're not worried about speaking what they feel, but they're worried about somebody tracking them down, that's where you might offer anonymity, or you might at least offer last name anonymity, so you would use their first name only. Finding ways to negotiate with them, in a sense, and this is for the average person, negotiate with them so that they feel comfortable. Before you know, let them go completely, figure out if there's a way, if you identify them as a 55-year-old teacher and you just don't say their name or where they work, will they be confident with that? So working with them, I mean, these are people, and they do not have a duty to speak to us. Any time that they give us, it's on their own watch. We don't pay for information, for stories. So we need to respect that they're giving us something that would make our stories wouldn't be possible without them, but they don't owe us anything. So just being caring and respectful and working with them. And then the other thing is source development. And if you can, if you have the time to build a relationship with your sources over time, even people that you don't know if you'll be using often, that does make it a lot easier. There were a lot of pot shop openings where I would literally call the owner of the shop just to confirm the days and times they're going to be open, just so that I could start a conversation with them. And I would say, you know, this is off the record, I'm just working on a story about your opening, how's it going? And I would just kind of get them to start talking, not for a story, so that if I have to call them in the future, we've already spoken. They have my number, I have theirs. I can remind them of that last time we spoke. So building that relationship is really important.
Well, thank you guys so much for taking the time to speak with us. This was really insightful. So to the attendees, our next speaker session will be next Wednesday. And this evening at 5 p.m., we'll have our first instructional session. So tune into that. So yeah, thank you guys all for coming. And we'll end it here.